essential career decision for them to deny this issue. And I'm at the same time communicating with pilots that have reached out to me on this issue that are direly concerned, that are afraid to speak out for very obvious reasons. In fact, I've had two Gulfstream pilots reach me in the last 60 days. One's a former military. So they fly private jets. In fact, some of them flew some of the Democratic officials to the last convention, and not that they like any of those officials, but that's their job. And they brought up to me that the reason they reached out is because they had just experienced, each of them, emergency alarms go off on their jets, forcing them to descend from above 40,000 feet to far below because the temperatures outside were 35 degrees above where they should be. Air was not dense enough to hold that aircraft. These people are absolutely alarmed. And for those quote-unquote pilots, whether they are or whether they aren't, whether their ideology blinds them and they're unwilling to see reality, and we have lots of cases of that, don't we, George? I mean, we live in a country where 47-story steel structure high-rise buildings can collapse in 7 seconds, the third building in World Trade Center, which I know you know of,
mm-hmm.
and we're told it happened because some furniture was burning on the first floor. And anybody who could believe that would discount what they see with their own eyes happening above us. So
sell them some swampland, would you?
Well, yeah, I mean, we're really living in an Orwellian era. But don't you find it interesting, George, that with all the environmentalist groups, Bill McKibben, 350.org, and NRDC, Sierra Club, Greenpeace, that none of them are willing to address the climate engineering? Don't you find that unimaginably hypocritical?
Yeah, it's strange. It's strange. Let's talk a little bit about Antarctica.
But, I mean, on that issue, do you find it strange that, I'll go there, but that none of these environmental groups are willing to talk about this issue?
I don't know if they're afraid or why.
They're afraid of their 501c3s. They're afraid of losing their nonprofits. So I'll go on to Antarctica now. I just want to make the statement that, you know, as a person who is very environmentally minded, I am, I'm unimaginably disappointed and feel betrayed by these quote-unquote environmental groups that claim to care about the environment, all of whom are ignoring the single greatest environmental threat of all. The floor is yours, George.
And it's there. All they have to do is test it.
That's all.
That simple. Okay, Antarctica. They're talking about all kinds of strange things down there, Dane, that maybe a huge asteroid struck down there. Who knows what? But what do you hear? What's going on there?
If you're speaking about the evacuations, there's an ice shelf that's collapsing. There's two ice shelves collapsing. One is Larsen B, and one is on the other side of the peninsula where there's a British research station that is being evacuated because the whole ice shelf is cracking apart.
Because of temperature change?
Yes. You okay. have thermal expansion happening, and once these mechanisms start to accelerate, the equation becomes very nonlinear. So right now we have a crack on Larsen B shelf that's about 110 or 120 miles long. It looks like something out of the Day After Tomorrow movie, George. You've seen that,
correct?
That
big split, yeah.
Exactly. It looks just like that. So we're talking about, by some reports, a piece of ice that may be as much as 6,500 square kilometers. This is a uncharted territory for an ice piece of ice that big to break off the shelf. It could happen any time. Certainly will happen very soon. And it's not just the ice breaking off that's critical. It's the fact that that ice shelf is what helps hold the land-based ice back. Once that cleat is gone, the land-based ice begins to slide into the water quite rapidly. And we're seeing this. And those that don't believe that ice is melting, the oceans are rising, I'm just asking them to do some real research. Miami's pumping out every high tide. Have you seen any of the data from Miami?
Mm-hmm. No, I haven't seen the data.
If your listeners look at that, Miami just spent $500 million, just to try to pump out a few neighborhoods.
Wow.
This is happening right now. So
just to keep their shorelines intact.
Exactly. So I'm just asking people again to look at this. This is not advocating for Al Gore or carbon credits. I've said three times already. I'm just trying to get people to look at reality and understand one of the primary goals of climate engineering is to keep the populations confused and divided as to the true severity of the damage until the last possible moment.
The conspiracy theorists talk about the Nazis are still there, that there could be an underwater city, that there could be UFOs. I mean, there's all kinds of things coming about that place.
Don't know anything about that, but I do know that, again, the evacuations that we're talking about now is a British research team that's on an ice shelf that's breaking apart, and they feel that ice shelf won't last the winter, so I believe 70 or 80 of them are being evacuated right now.
Are they in trouble?
I don't think they're in any mortal danger yet, but if you look at drone footage of the size of this fissure, it's immense. Certainly that ice shelf is going to break off. Once that happens, it would be very precarious to try to rescue this team and their equipment. So they're simply pulling them off now. And when we have, I'll back up a hair on the New Zealand issue, just to add a little credence or to the Japanese quake, actually. This is right from MIT. I just want to read this for your listeners. This is from MIT's Technology Review. Quote, infrared emissions directly above the epicenter increased dramatically in the days before the devastating earthquake in Japan, said scientists. And they are very puzzled over the reports of strange atmospheric phenomena in the days before the quake. Now, this is right from MIT. George, do you remember the French foreign minister that said 500 days till climate chaos while he was standing next to John Kerry?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So we're past 500 days, but again, Kerry comes into the picture. He was in New Zealand before the quake and left right prior to. Just asking people to consider and understand the degree to which the climate has been manipulated for 70-plus years right in front of our faces, and we have the Senate documents to prove this, George. We have a 750-page Senate document any of your listeners can look at. If they simply search geoengineering massive Senate document, they'll find our post, important sections highlighted, very easy to go through. That document specifically states that normally adversarial countries, i.e. Russia, China, U.S., it doesn't name the countries, but it simply states normally adversarial countries, there are many others involved as well, will cooperate with the global weather modification climate engineering programs because of cross-border ramifications. So we have collusion and cooperation between all the major competing powers on this issue for their own reasons.
Why do you think then Secretary of State John Kerry went to Antarctica? I mean, what's there for him to look at?
Well, there's a massive microwave transmitter there. We know that. In fact, we posted on this exact issue on the New Zealand quake, and we posted NASA satellite data imagery that shows the radio frequency transmission signature coming from the Antarctic region where this transmitter is located at the approximate time of the quake. So people can connect the dots on their own. And I would challenge them to, if this certainly challenges all of our beliefs as far as what's possible. But George, if we went back 100 years and said you could talk on a box to anybody anywhere in the world, would anybody believe that? And yet we know that's true. When you split an atom, what happens? Who would have believed that 100 or 150 years ago?
Many details are still kept under secrecy in classified government documents.
We don't know the precise number, but millions of people, at one time or another during the 1950s and 60s, were inhaling the biological or chemical agents that the Army had been spraying.
Human experimentation hasn't been limited to the United States. The British government recently admitted that millions were secretly sprayed with a toxic chemical in the 1950s and 60s. Military officials conducting germ warfare experiments thought they were spraying a harmless substance, but later discovered the chemicals may have contributed to medical problems. Critics accused the government of gambling with public health.